Hello everyone, welcome to another webinar organized by us at Archipedia. I am Anupama Sharma, an architect and co-founder of Archipedia, where we want to create a resource base, a common platform to interact and share knowledge among architects and designers. Today we have architect Mohit Pariyani, who will be taking the webinar on CAD drawing standards for professional output. Architect Mohit Pariyani is an alumni of Maulana Azad NIT Bhopal with 11 years of experience. He has an established firm in Indore, Madhya Pradesh, and over the course of time, he has trained over 50 architects and draftsmen under him. His work includes diverse range of projects like hospitals, hotels, residential, commercial, etc. Over the years, he has developed a strong command on the CAD software, and today he will be sharing with us some tips and tricks. I welcome you, sir, and I hand over the mic and the screen to you.
Thank you. Hello, Anupama. It's good to be here. And hello, everyone. Welcome to the webinar. I'll just do the output. Just a moment. Welcome to the webinar. I am architect Mohit Pariyani, your host for the webinar, and I would like to give you a brief introduction about myself. I am an architect by profession and I have a field experience of around 11 years, and as an architect I have trained around 50 plus architects and draftsmen in the various professional timeline. And in this webinar I'll be giving you a few points on how to manage the CAD files, the few tips and tricks how to manage the CAD files from the beginning to the end. We all know CAD is a basic graphic tool. And whatever we can do on paper is something which we can replicate on CAD, and even better. The better the imagination, the better the drafting quality, and the better the understanding of what we can do on CAD. But there are few tips and tricks available in CAD interface which can be followed by which things which we normally miss during the drafting can be managed by using the CAD interface itself, and which can be definitely modified on a later stage as per our drawing needs, and it can help us save time on a longer run. We know how to do the work, we always know how to make the details, but because of some silly mistakes, we normally cripple our reputation in front of the clients and the contractors, which can be avoided using the CAD interface better. So this webinar will help us highlight some of these mistakes, and some solutions to that would be also given in the webinar. I would like to put to note that there will be around 10 tricks available in the webinar, and I would request everybody to keep a note of what, who knew by far. For example, if anybody who knew around 2 to 3 tricks from the webinar, he can assess and write himself as 3 on 10 for the understanding that he knew 3 tricks already and 7 is what he has learned by far from the webinar. And again, I would like to inform everybody that this webinar is for organizing CAD files only. There will be no teaching of commands on how to do the CAD work, expecting that most of you know that already. There are some tricks which can be used better for understanding and better organizing CAD, and in this webinar we would be focusing only tips to organize CAD. Again, I would like to inform that we are using ZWCAD in the platform, but the commands and the interface are mostly similar for all CAD interface like AutoCAD, RogiCAD, NanoCAD and various other interfaces. So we are using ZWCAD as the base for now, and the same can be replicated in all the other CAD softwares as the interface is mostly the same. Sorry. And also I would like to put to point that all the queries whatsoever would be resolved at the end of the webinar, either if we have the time, so directly in the webinar itself, or if not, then via mail. So I would request everybody to wait for the webinar to end, and if we have the time, we'll resolve it here itself, and if not, we'll be doing it at the end of the webinar after the webinar in mails. So let's start with the first break. The first trick which I suggest is go for starting a scratch file. And the first thing which we should do in this is arranging the units. The first basic line of command which we should do is arranging the unit in which we want to work. That goes by the UN command, and everybody has their own preferences, either to work in feet, inches, meter, millimeter, or as per their own convenience, the dimension. I would strongly suggest to go for decimal point in millimeter. Reason being, that is the minimum measurable unit as on site and with the most precision as available to us. Though we have better units available, but millimeter is the most understandable in Indian standards and universally also. And since we are working in millimeters, so I would suggest the precision to be zero units. Reason being, any fraction of millimeter would not be very useful in measuring on site. It might be good in drawing, but measuring and delivering it on site would not be very doable. So again, setting it to millimeter with a precision of zero is the first thing which we should do while doing the work, while starting the work itself. Same goes with the angle. Any angle which is readable without fractions should be considered. So the same decimal degree with zero precision is always workable in any grounds. So this was the first initial command we should always follow on this. Once doing this, the second trick should be organizing the dimension style. That should go by D enter. We all mostly know that. But there are a few guidelines which we should follow while making a dimension style. For example, I'll just create a new dimension style that in front of you. It should preferably be with a new, I strongly suggest to make a new dimension style, because anything with the base standard is always replicated in the same interface every time. So anything with a unique name would be assigned and dedicatedly yours to work on commands. So for example, if I take the style name as MM, most understandable and recognizable in conditions. The first trick is to set the line type as hidden. Reason being, any line which is hidden is considered as of importance, but as reference, not as the primary line for execution. Any line which is hidden is always considered that it is of use in the plan, but it is not to be executed. So that is the difference which we want to give to the dimension line from the main execution of working lines. So that the dimension lines are always differentiated from the main execution lines or working lines of the drawings. Same way, the line weight should be set to bilayer, so that definitely we should work in layers, but anything, any dimension style, any line weight which you want to apply on that shall be applied at one place, and it shall be replicated in all of the drawings and dimensions. This is the second trip. Then coming to the text line, we normally have a problem that we have issue with the point that the text which are kept straight are not identifiable as to which line are they connected to. For example, if the text is straight, I'll just show you how. If the text is straight, it might get intertangled with different dimensions, and you might not find that which text is of which dimension. So I would strongly suggest to keep the text aligned to the dimension line itself, so that we can in one view itself understand that this dimension belongs to this text, this line. And the next point comes out to be as the primary units. The units which we already defined are in mm, so I am strongly suggesting to work in mm. And definitely this mm being the smallest figure in terms of units, there is no need of precision of 0.00 or 0.0 required. So the precision again should be made as zero. And also there are some problems as seen on site. Any dimension below 5 mm might not be doable on site. It might be measurable, but in terms of execution, it might not be doable. So keeping a round off to 5 mm is strongly suggested. The reason being, it comes out to be the best practice if the contractors understand in terms of repetitions of 5 or 10 units. That is more executable. That is more understandable by the contractor, even the layman. And that is why I suggest to keep the round off of the mm units to 5. Same can be done in terms of meter as 0.005. That would again make it 5 mm as the required minimum applied dimension in terms of dimension styles. So these helped us in making a drawing more executable. So I do this and I set the current timeline, current dimension style as mm. This was the second suggestion. The third one comes out to be of the similar scale, is setting the text styles. They go by the command of style, style. Once you do this, there would be a pop-up window defining the text style available with us. Again, I would strongly suggest to make a new text style rather than modifying the standard, because if you copy the text accordingly, it comes back to the base standard in every drawing. So a new or unique name is always suggested for text and dimension both. So a new text style would be by the name of general details as general. And for height, there's a formula for height working out. If you're giving out the drawing in 1:100 scale, that is mostly we do the plans and elevations in scale of 1:100. So the minimum readable height of a text is normally 2 mm. So I would strongly suggest to make it 2 mm, that would be 2 × 100, that would be 200 units for the fixed text height. Same way you can apply this and add a new detail, add a new text style for details by the name of details. And understanding that the details may vary from scale of 1:20 to 1:50. For example, if we are talking about a detail of scale 1:25, so 25 cross 2 mm height, as said before, should make the text height to be 50 mm, 50 units. So we apply this and we make a base of text style as we need. Reason being, this would be one less thing to worry about on a longer run of working and executing the drawing, so that we can focus more on the details and less on these mistakes, whether the text is readable or not that way. So initial commands of these type are, they don't look very important, but are very important in terms if we are starting as a new scratch work. They help us unknowingly on a longer run. So we set this. This is the end of the third trick. Now the next command is, next trick is basically the use of attributes in title blocks. For example, I have a demo drawing available with me, as you all can see. These are drawings I've already made. And I'll just show you, understanding that your drawing work is already complete, focusing on the title block alone itself, I'll use the attribute command. And please note that attribute command is not only restricted to title blocks, but many sources. But for the time being, for the use of the webinar, I am showing it on title block itself. There are many multiple users available, which can be discussed on a later stage. So this is a demo format of mine available with all the fixed things marked in it. For example, my general notes, which would not change, my basic drawing numbers, which would not change even after project to project, a general description of door window schedule. This might change from project to project, but being it as a standard, I have kept it organized for the time being. Revision numbers, seal and signature, and the things which are variable are left as blank. For example, the project name, the client name, drawing name, drawing by, check by, scale, date, and the drawing number. So for this, I'll just show you how to do it. I'll initiate the attribute command in this, which is by the short command of AET, enter. You see, there would be a pop-up window. And in this, I can suggest the name of the attribute, the information which is needed to when the attribute is not written, for you to understand what is to be written in this. For example, I just write project, project, and I'll select the text style as mm. I'll prompt the information about it, like what I need to put in this, like this project details. Please note that this would not be visible in any part of attribute. This is for your information only. And then next place is to write the default text, if any. For the project name, I don't think there would be a default set for anybody, but if anybody has it, he can write it down. And then I'll select the location of where it is to be placed. Once done, I'll say define and exit. So you see there's an attribute added right over here with the name which I just entered. And then again, I can add another attribute by the name of client. Client underscore name. Please note that there is no possibility of writing space in the name. So either we have to make do with either underscore or at the rate as per your convenience. And the same again is located again in terms of mm as the text height, located over here, and I press define and exit. So a client name attribute is placed over here. Similarly, I can copy the attribute and rename it itself to save time. That would be drawing. So just by double clicking on it, I rename the attribute as drawing, and another attribute is created right over here. Same way, another smaller attribute for drawn by, I'll just write it down like this, drawn underscore by, and I'll take the text height as detail dimension small. I'll locate it over here and I'll say define and exit. You see the text style as I marked was very small, so it is placed right now, but I can overall change it whenever I need. For example, I'm scaling the text as 5 times right now. Even that is small, I'll scale it as 4 more times. This is something which would be readable, so I'll just place the attribute right over here. I'll copy it on further locations to save time. And I'll rename it on a later stage. For example, this was drawn by, this was checked by, this is the scale, this is drawing number. And you see, I have left the space for date. I'll just define a new attribute with the name of date, and I'll let the interface use the space for this. There's a space after default text. There's an icon which can be clicked. It will give up the information like something which is always changing, but the interface can take it or take it directly from the computer itself. For example, I can select the plot date, the date on which the drawing is being plotted. That date would automatically be updated in the attribute whenever printed. So I'll just select plot date, the format in which I want to print, and I'll press OK. And I'll locate it again with MM, and I'll locate it right at the space of date. And I'll say define and exit. Now see, the text is quite bigger, so I can definitely scale it down as per my need. For example, I'm scaling it to 60% of what I need. Once all the attributes are placed in the title block, all I have to do is make a block of the title completely, and the attribute location would be taken from you by the interface itself. For example, I'll complete the command like this. I'll select the title block, initiate the block making command by B, enter. I'll pick the base point, and I'll write the name of the block. There's already a block by the name of title in this, so I'll make it as title 2 or title demo for us to understand. And once I'm pressing OK, the block is being created, and the interface is asking me for the information which I need to replace with the attribute name. These information are, once you place the block anywhere in the drawing, the interface will ask the information right away from you so that you don't miss it. For example, project name, I'll write webinar, client name, webinar, drawing, demo, drawn by Mohit, checked by Mohit, scale as 1:100 for the time being, drawing number, demo, one. And date I would not modify. If I want to modify, I can do it, but I would strongly suggest not to modify any default thing. Reason being, the date would be taken out by the interface itself without you prompting it. So once you press OK, you see the block has replaced every text which I have written, every attribute which I have written, to its text which I have just filled out right now. And the date area is left as hashtag, because whenever you initiate the print command, this hashtag will be replaced by the date on which you are printing it. So you need not change it every time you give a print to the client or to the contractor or to anybody for reference also. You can refer the date on which it was given. So this was the end of attribute command, the fourth trick which we had. After this, once we have the attribute command set, it would be somewhat like this. If you can see, as the attribute would be placed somewhat like this. It can be modified as per your need. Whenever this would be printed, the date would be updated automatically as per your convenience, as per the interface, as per the timeline it is showing in the computer. So this would be the final output if you do it correctly. Again, coming to the next command is the use of layout and viewport. Once we are done with making the title block and drawings, we normally compose the drawing in the model space itself, but the use of layout is actually something which can be used on a longer scale for managing the drawing files. I'll just show you. I'll just open a layout which is default available in any CAD interface. There's already a viewport available, so I strongly suggest to delete it. Now I'll tell you how to set up a page in viewport, in layout. I'll just right click on layout available, and there's a page setup icon. I'll press it. You see, I have by default set two pages, A3 and A4 already. I'll make a new set, a new page style by A2 for you to understand. I'll press new. I'll rename as A2. I'll press OK with it. And I'll set all the basic defaults which I need. For example, my printer name, my paper size, which I'm selecting it to be as A2. My print area, which would be the layout, scale to line weights, fit to paper, the plot style which I want, which is the CTB file, the orientation. And once I'm done selecting everything, I'll just press OK. And I'll press set current. Now you see, something like this is already updated as per real-time working. If you select A3 and set current, it will set the paper as A3. If you set A4 and set current, it will set the paper as A4. For the time being, I'm going ahead with A3 for you all to understand. I'll press set current, I'll press OK. This is a default A3 paper printable size. The dotted is the printable version, And outside the dotted is the blank space which is left by the printer by default. Now I'll place the block which I just created, demo title block, T-I-T-L-E, demo, over here. And it would be asking for the same things again. Scale factor is 1, rotation is 0, and the attribute details are again asked by the interface itself to me so that I don't forget them. Project details would be webinar again. Client name, this is the space where it is all written. Client name as, sorry, I just didn't type webinar. The next command comes out to be as drawing name, what is it written as? Drawing demo plan drawn by Mohit, checked by Mohit. Scale 1:100. Drawing number demo. And the date, I'll just press enter so that the default text is not changed. And the block is placed. But you see the block is now far too big because I have placed the block in 1:1 scale and the block was actually made in 1:100 scale. So I'll just rescale it as 0.001. Sorry, 0.01. And it would be somewhat in the range of the text I need. I'll place it in the printable area of the layout, which is inside the dotted line, as close as possible. And you see there is something, some of it is still going out. I'll rescale it according to the printed space, not the paper available. I'll rescale it like this. It's mostly in the printable version. There's a line missing, so I'll just select the block and right-click and put edit in place. I'll press OK and I'll make the missing line in it. Please remember that double-clicking on the block would open the attribute, and right-click and opening the block in the place is something which will make you edit the block. You can't just double-click on the block to edit it after the attributes are placed in it. So this is it. This is placing the title block in the layout. Now what we'll do is use the viewports to compose the drawing in the view, in the layout area. I suggest you all to open the viewport dialog box like this. This is the viewport command line box, which is available in every interface. You can just right click on any space, open the CAD interface, and there would be a viewport point which is available. If not ticked, you can tick it out and the block would be visible in this. And using a viewport is something very, very easy and very, very fluent once you go through it. For example, I'll just create a rectangular single viewport in this drawing so that you see how easy it is. I have placed the rectangle viewport command, and once I've created the viewport, all the drawing which is in the model space would be visible in the layout space, but shrinked as per the size of the viewport. I can double click in the viewport and zoom in as per my need to make the only drawing which is to be printed visible. And I'll set the scale as per my need, for example, 1:100. This would be in the scale of 1:100. And then I'll double click outside and I'll select the viewport and I'll lock it in the properties area. I'll do this as display log and I'll press yes. That means the display which is visible right now in the viewport would be logged. Even if I double click and zoom in and zoom out, the display in the scale of 1:100 would be locked. So we can arrange multiple details and log them so that we don't have any error on a later scale regarding the scale of the drawing or the detail. So once I've created a viewport, now as I see this space is quite empty, I can create multiple viewports and show multiple drawings in the viewport command like this. I'll reduce the size of this viewport by just as if I'm modifying the dimension or modifying a rectangle right now. I've reduced the viewport to a smaller size, and once done, I can move this viewport as per my convenience to locate it in any part of my drawing paper. And after that, I can create multiple viewports in the same layout itself. They need not be of rectangle form. They can be circular. They can be polygon. They can be of any form which is closed. Any polygon which is closed can be made as a viewport. For example, this is a polygon viewport command in which I'll make a polygon of not so defined format, but I'll close it. And once done, this would be a viewport. I can zoom in on any particular detail which I want to print. For example, this one. Give it a scale of 1:25 for say. Since it is a very smaller detail, I can, once I am done setting this, I'll select it out. I'll lock the display. And then I can modify the polygon viewport also, so that the viewport is arranged as per the size of the detail. In fact, even if there's a polygon available, I can create the polygon to a viewport. For example, if I create a circle right here, and I want to create it to be as a viewport, so I'll just select convert object to viewport. I'll select the polyline. I'll press enter, and that particular polyline would be converted into a viewport as per my need. I can zoom in, zoom out. I can make the detail visible, only that detail visible. And I can zoom out. I can lock it. And I'm done with composing my drawing in viewports. Now this might look very casual to you, and it is very easy, and you can see what the output can be once you have done this. I'll show you a demo layout which I've created. Not so much time, but it is very easily doable, and this is something which can be done. This is a door window sheet, this is the table, and this is the detail of sill level which I've created, all in the scale. This is in the scale of 1:25, as you can see. This in scale of 1:50, as you can see. The text is again in the scale of 1:50. And the sheet is composed without scaling anything towards the actual drawing. I mean, if you see in the model space, the detail is this small and the main line is this big. I was having no need of scaling any detail to smaller or bigger size just to fit in a format. It is done in the viewport without modifying the actual dimension of the details. So that is the advantage of viewports and layouts. So this was the end of the fifth trick which we can do. Now coming out, the next is a smaller trick, but quite useful. So those who already know what layout is, they might have seen a problem which comes out that anything which is dotted or dashed or with any different line type available in model space is not visible the same way in paper space, that is in layouts. For example, anything which is, as you can see here, is dashed over here, the dimension which I marked, the dimension is not dashed in this space, paper space. So there is a very common, very neat trick available for that. All you have to do is go into the model space and repeat the command PSLD scale and press enter. That would make something PSLD scale value as 1. It should be 1, and then repeat the same in the paper space layout which you want to do. For example, I want it to be dashed the way it is in this particular layout. I'll double click in this and I'll repeat the command PSLD scale. It means paper space line type scale. I'll press enter 0 and generate it. Value should be set as 0 in model space and in paper space also. So this would make something like anything which is dotted or dashed or any line type available with the line type scale as in model space would be repeated in the paper space by default by itself. So you see, just by a small command, my drawing is completely organized with an attributed title block and viewports and line type as per my need, just by setting everything right. So we are using the interface for organizing the CAD. So this was the sixth command to you. Now moving ahead is something which is very unique if we are using overlay of drawings one on another. For example, I'll just show you. This is a demo drawing which we've already made. This is an overlay drawing of a plan which I've made. This has furniture plans, this has electrical, this has working drawing, all superimposed definitely in layers, but all superimposed one on another so that I don't miss changing it in one drawing and not changing it in another drawing. So it is something which is very much doable if you're working in layers. And there lies the next trick which is given to you in this webinar, is the use of layer state manager. You see, in the layer command, there's a thing called layer state manager in the top left corner. Once you open it, I've created a 3 default sets available This layer state manager basically remembers the states of layer on which you're working and saves it as a shortcut. For example, I've set and I've saved the furniture set like this. I'll just restore it. I have turned off the center line, the dimension, the levels, the tree, and electrical drawing, and I've saved the layer state as furniture. That would make everything with walls, doors, and furniture visible. Everything else would be turned off. This was the layer state in which I've saved it as furniture. I'll just add another layer state right in front of you. For example, if I want to save only the door window details or only the dimensions without the center line, I'll just change it. I'll turn off the electrical itself. I'll turn off the furniture for the time being. And you see, this is the type which is saved right now. I'll just go to the layer state manager, add a new layer state manager as demo one, and I'll press OK and I'll press save. It will do such thing that any layer which was on at that time will be kept on, and anything which was off at that time would be kept off. Whenever I restore it to demo one, it would do the same. I would, for example, if I'm working on furniture layer state, it would make the furniture on, and immediately if I want to switch to demo one, I'll just go to layer state manager. I'll double click on the demo one, or I'll just click once and press restore, and it would be changing itself as the layer state in which I was originally working. Now, this might not be very, it might not look very useful right now, but if you're working on layouts, it's quite a thing which can be of multiple use. For example, this is a drawing second layout. I can copy multiple layouts like this, and all I need to do is change the layer state manager, and I'll have multiple drawings available with me right in the right format, right in the right scale, without modifying much of it. For example, I'll just double click on this layout. I'll go to the layer state manager. I'll restore the furniture layer state. I'll press OK. Now you see my drawing, which was working drawing initially, is now converted to a furniture drawing. Same way, if I want to convert it as to electrical, I initially saved the electrical layer state. I'll just save the restore the electrical layer state right now. I'll press OK, and the drawing is now converted to an electrical drawing. So just by a few clicks, my type of drawing, my multiple levels of drawing, my multiple uses of drawing is converted just by modifying a single output. So this is layer state manager to everyone. Coming to the next point, is one of the advantages featured in every CAD version available is the usage of CTB files. And I must tell you what CTB are. CTB is the color interface file which is given, which remembers your printing schedules so that you can modify it as per your need. For example, I'll just initiate the print command and I'll use A3 right now. Select the layout and go for preview. Now the drawing was made in A4, so now anything which is printable in A3 would have this much open space. So I'll change it to A4 again and I'll select preview. You see, everything is black and white because here in the plot style table, I've selected the monochrome CTB. Monochrome CTB converts every colored impact line to black and white until unless it has a true color. So managing these files could be of very use to you if you want to highlight anything in a specific drawing. For example, I'll just show you how it was. I've prepared an electrical CTB file for which I'll show you what the output can change with. It would be somewhat, I've selected the wrong CTB, electrical 2 as this. This is the output without changing the color of any dedicated part of the drawing. Only the output would change, not the drawing. Now you see, I have highlighted in the CTB is anything with the color magenta shall remain magenta, and everything else shall be converted as gray color. This is the command line which can be useful, the CTB command, actual use of the CTB commands in this. I'll just show you how it can be done. I'll create a new CTB and I'll use create from scratch and I'll press next. I'll give it a name as demo1. I'll press next. I'll select the print style table editor. And anything which I want to modify, I must go with the color coding only. the 256 color coding available in any CAD interface. For example, I'll just select every color right now. And by every color, I mean every color available in the print style table editor. There are 256 colors available in this. And I'll select the color and make every color as black. That would define the monochrome output. And now comes the fun part. Once I'm done with this, all I have to do is select any color. For example, magenta was the color of electrical layer which I have used. I can make it as change color to red. And I'll press OK. The same can be done to change the line weight of the color, change the line end style, line joint style, minor modifications which can be used to highlight any particular part of the drawing. I'll press OK. I'll press Finish. Now, what you see here as everything which was of any other color is now black, and even the magenta color electrical layer is now converted to red color output only. I haven't modified anything in the drawing, but the output has been modified and programmed just by managing a good CTV file. So you can always make something highlighted based on the color available right now in the interface. So this was CTV file. Now the advantage of CTV is that you cannot change the color of everything you want to highlight, but you can set a selective color. For example, color 25 or color 24, and you can use that color that it should be highlighted in every drawing whenever you work on. That would help you to create and highlight any detail if you want to focus on something in a particular drawing. And also, this layer state, this CTB file once made, would be repeated in every drawing which you make in the CAD same interface, the same software. For example, once I've created a demo CTB, it would be repeated in every command line available, in every drawing available. For example, look, demo 1 was created in demo drawing 2, and it is also available in demo drawing 1. It is also available in demo drawing 4. So if you create it once, it would be replicated everywhere in every drawing. Whether you want to use it or not, that is purely up to you. But that CTB file would be available in every drawing. So that is also an advantage of CTB files. Now coming up to the ninth trick is the use of plot stamps. Now many of you might know it, many of you might not know it. It's like a watermark which you want to keep with least importance, but when needed, it is the most useful thing in the CAD interface. For example, I'll just show you. Once I've run the print command, everything I've organized, there's an icon by the name of plot stamp on in the right side of the print area. I've clicked here. It goes off. But when I've clicked it on, now you see there is a plot stamp available with the location where I've marked it. And it shows the location of my drawing, the scale, and various other things which I need. It might not be visible right now, but when needed, it helps us find the drawing and tell us at what time the drawing was printed and the what scale of the drawing is, what paper was the drawing supposed to print it on, and many such small things. For example, I'll show you how to modify it. There's an icon by the right side of the plot stamp on tag. It goes right here. And you can always select these points which are available right in front of you, that if they should be visible in the plot stamp or not. For example, the drawing name gives the actual locational address of the drawing, the paper size on which it is printed and in what scale it is printed, the date and time of which it was printed. You can always add or edit a watermark for your firm name or the person or the name of the person on which who is working on it. You can do it like this by adding add. You can add something. I can write Mohit as my name in this, that I worked on the drawing. Or I can write MEA as my firm's name and I'll press OK. I can select if I want it to be visible. I can select Mohit. And one more thing, the location of plot stamp can be also modified as per your need. Go into the advanced tool. You can select the location of the plot stamp. For example, I've created bottom right. I'll select bottom left and vertical orientation and the height of the plot stamp to be 2 mm. I'll press OK. And I'll press OK and I'll go for a preview. So initially the plot stamp which was over here has been shifted over here. So it might not be of very use when not needed, but when you have the drawing which is brought by the client or the contractor and you want to check or modify the drawing further, you can look into the location of the drawing where it was saved and you can start working on it right away after locating the same drawing. normally we have errors like we might not find the right drawing and start working on the wrong drawing on which there were some misconceptions allowed. So this plot stamp helps us locating the drawing on which we have the print. Plus the scale, the drawing which was printed on what date and what time, on which paper size and which scale, and printed by who with a watermark. So this is plot stamps for you. This was the 9th trick in the webinar. And coming out to the 10th trick. The 10th trick, guys, is something very, you can say as not very much of a use if you have a licensed version, but if you are using an academic version and if you have error in something as removing the education stamp, so this is the trick which can be used for that. Now, I have a licensed version of ZWCAD, so my education stamp is already removed. So for you guys to understand, I have downloaded a trial version of ZWCAD for making the plot stamp visible if it is in a drawing or not. So I'll just show it to you right now. I'll just change the screens. Guys, this is a drawing which has an education plot stamp available right now. I mean, I'll just show it to you how it is. If you open the print command and select the printable area and go for a preview of this, you see there is a plot stamp of education version available, designed by ZWCAD academic version. And this is something which is not visible in every drawing, but any drawing which is made in the education version of the CAD software. So I'll show you a trick how you can remove this in CAD itself. What we'll do is, once we are done with completing the file, we'll save the file as a DXF format. For example, I'll just save the same file as same name and in the form of DXF. And I'll close the file. It will ask to save the file again, but I'll say no. Once done, I'll open the file again, and the same file, once opened, will not be asking for a plot stamp recognition. I mean, the plot stamp is now removed. Now what you can do is save the file either with a different name or with the same name again in the DWG format. I'll save as, I'll go for DWG, and I'll save education stamp new. I'll save the file and I'll start working on the file, and now you see the plot stamp is now removed. It's now gone. Poof. So this was the 10th trick to remove the education plot stamp. And this leads us to the end of the webinar. And I would like to thank Archipedia for the platform and such well-organized knowledge sessions, and wish them all the best for the future endeavors. Also, I would like to inform all that we are also organizing a 5-day workshop in collaboration with Archipedia on baseline for professional drawing standards. The workshop would be focused on the beginners on how to start from scratch and achieve a minimum baseline standard professional drawing, and how to achieve it in the best time possible. How can sticking to the standard can increase your drawing quality and overall maintain your professional output to its best practices. Post the workshop, you'll be more confident on the drawings you create. It would be better in terms of output from your end. Further details of the workshop would be shared on mail with every participant of the webinar. And now it's time to find out our score, your score on the number of tricks you already knew before the webinar. So let's start with it in the chat window. Thank you. And thank you everybody for listening.
Thank you, Mohit sir, for the informative session. And I thank you all for joining us today. The 5-day CAD workshop is priced at Rs. 1600. But since you all have joined us today in this webinar, we are offering you a special discount of 30% off. Grab the limited opportunity, as the coupon is valid only till Monday midnight, that is tomorrow midnight. And I'm sure you all will be interested in learning more about creating a professional and organized drawing standard. So grab the limited opportunity now. Also, I want to inform everyone that the video of the webinar will be shared in YouTube and the link will be mailed to you all. So stay tuned with us, as we are going to be conducting interesting webinars in the future. Thank you so much. See you.